2 Timothy chapter 3. If you would please stand for the reading of God's Word, if you're able to. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Some people you would find them about anywhere. You might find them out on the lake fishing. You might find them out on the golf course one day. Like, it reminds me of a fellow that was out playing golf and with his best friend one morning, and I don't know, it was probably about 10, 11 o'clock, and the golf course was pretty close to the highway. About that time, they seen a hearse and a line of cars coming down the highway. And that man stopped and took off his hat, bowed his head, and began to pray. They passed on by, and he raised his head back up, put his cap back on. The other fellow said, "Man," he said, "I've never seen anything like that." He said, "You really care, don't you?" He said, "Well, I was married to her for 35 years. So you never know, amen? 2 Timothy chapter 3, begin reading verse 1. It says, "This know also that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and led captive silly women laden with sins and led away with divers lust, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth, men of corrupt minds reprobate concerning the faith." We've been in this series preaching about Timothy, and of course Paul's in prison while he's writing this. And this is really, 2 Timothy is the last letter that the Apostle Paul writes before he's executed. And he's reminding Timothy to stand true to the Word of God, to stay faithful, to remain faithful to the Lord and to serve God and to preach the gospel. He begins to warn him as we've seen in chapter 2 and actually throughout the whole letter that the last days, perilous times will come, we see here in chapter 3, but difficult days, times when people will turn away from the Lord, turn away from the Word of God, turn away from the things of God. When he gets down to chapter 3 here, he says, "This also know." And then he begins to list the different things, the signs of the last days. And you say, "Well, preacher, that was so long ago, and here's Timothy," and he's telling Timothy, "This was written for you and I also, but it was beginning in that day." I don't know if you've ever been out anywhere, and you begin to, maybe you're driving, or you look around, and you begin to see some clouds roll up in the back somewhere, and you just begin to watch them. They get thicker, and they get thicker, and they get darker, and they begin to build, and they begin to build. And that's really what's happening, is what he's talking about here, is the perilous times. If you look at what's being spoken of, when he speaks of perilous times here, it would be that word perilous means difficult or dangerous times, times that would be difficult to live in, kind of like a storm, kind of like a storm. We just recently, this past week, we had the hurricane that hit landfall in Florida, and then was downgraded to a tropical storm, is making its way up the East Coast, and they're expecting flooding, and people's preparing for it and getting ready. The storm began to build out in the ocean, and before it ever made it to land, they begin to see what was going to take place. They begin to monitor to see roughly how hard it would hit as it hit land. And so we see here that Paul is telling Timothy, he said, "This also know that in the last days, perilous times shall come, difficult times." I'd like to preach to you on the other side of the storm. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the day that you've blessed us with, and truly, Lord, we are blessed. Lord, we're very faulty in our own lives. And Lord, there's none of us that are good. Lord, we understand the Scripture to say that. But Lord, I pray that you would even meet with us today. Lord, we need your presence. We need your power. We need your strength. We ask, Lord, that you would do the work in hearts and lives that only you can do. No doubt in a crowd this size, Lord, there's some here that do not know Jesus Christ as their Savior. If they were to die today, they do not know that they'd go to heaven. Lord, I ask and I plead, Lord, that the Holy Spirit of God would convict their hearts and draw them this morning that they might be saved, that they might know that they're going to heaven when they die. But Lord, there's many needs among your people today. Lord, I pray that you'd strengthen every Christian. Lord, that you'd encourage each one. Lord, each person has something in their lives, Lord, that you would like to deal with and that you would like to strengthen them in. Lord, I pray that you'd encourage and strengthen. And now, Lord, we pray for our nation. Lord, we see perilous times in our nation. We see struggles. We see some very difficult days possibly ahead. And so, Lord, I ask that you would meet with us. Prepare our hearts, strengthen us, and may we stand for the honor and glory of Jesus Christ. And Lord, we look forward to the other side of the storm. And we'll thank you and we'll praise you for us. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. I believe that, you know, there's a storm building. And I believe he's talking about this here that we see in verse 1 here. I want to talk a little bit about a couple of other storms that's mentioned in the Bible. Probably one of the greatest storms that has ever hit this world, and that is the flood. And I want us to refer back to it, and there's another storm I want us to look at this morning, but in particular these two storms, and you can go through the Bible and you can find different types of storms and so forth, but in Genesis chapter 7, and you can flip there. I'm just going to read one verse there and then a couple other verses in Genesis. I'll read Genesis 7:1, Genesis 8:1, and Genesis 9:1 if you want to look at it. But in Genesis 7:1, the Lord said unto Noah, "Come thou and all thy house into the ark for thee, for I have seen righteousness before me in this generation." Most every person in this room realizes and knows the story behind the flood and how that Noah built the ark and how that God prepared to save Noah and his family to begin over with again. And so we see here that the ark has been built, and now the Lord comes to Noah and he said, "Noah," he said, "come thou and all thy house into the ark." He said, "I want you to come into the ark." The Lord was preparing Noah. He had already warned him of the storm that was coming, the flooding that was coming, the rain that was coming. And you've got to realize that in that day and time, it had never rained. They didn't even know what rain was. They didn't know what flooding was. Because the garden was watered by a mist that came up from the ground. And so this was something completely new to all of them. Yet Noah was obedient unto the Lord to listen to him and to build the ark. And you can imagine as people looked at Noah, you know, here he's building this ark out here in the middle of nowhere. Wasn't even close to the water. And people walking by said, "Man, Lord, Noah has lost it. He's crazy. Building a big boat out here and he ain't got any way to get it to the lake or get it to the river or get it to the ocean. And that thing's so big, it'll never float anyways." And no doubt people begin to mock him and make fun of him. But now the storm's beginning to brew. Probably the clouds begin to come into the sky. And the Lord calls unto Noah. He says, "Come into the ark here." I want you to notice here in verse 7, and he says in verse 1, "And the Lord said unto Noah," he spoke to him. Then if you turn to chapter 8 in verse 1, it says, "And God remembered Noah." Well, it's good to know that God remembers you. It's just like the Sister Blue saying about he knows your name. Isn't it good to know that God remembers you? Amen. You know, we all like to be remembered at some time, but it's good to know that the Lord remembers. In chapter 9 in verse 1 says, "And God blessed Noah." What you'll find here is you'll find that he remembered him and he blessed him on the other side of the storm. We find another storm that in Mark chapter 4. In Mark chapter 4 it says, "In the same day when the eve was come, he saith unto them, Let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him, even as he was in the ship." And that's talking about Jesus, who went down in the little ship and said, "And there were also with them other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind and waves and beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awake him and say unto him, Master, carest not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, Peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, What manner of man is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? And if you look down in the next chapter, chapter 5 begins there, and it says that, And they came over unto the other side of the sea. This is a continuation of chapter 4. We're the ones that put the chapters in there so we can find things easy. And so we find, it says, And they came over to the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. And we realize and remember the story of the Gadarene demonic that lived in the tombs and lived in the graveyard there in the Gadarenes. And he would come out, and they would try to bind him, and they would try to put clothes on him, and they would try to tame him down. And he was demon possessed. The Bible says that he would go through the tombs and cutting himself and ripping his clothes off and living wild, like a wild man, because he was possessed by these demons. Now Jesus has come over from the other side, and he's just come out of a storm, and now he's landed there at the Gadarenes, and he comes out, and here comes this man that has been demon possessed, and he kneels down and begins to worship Jesus Christ on the other side of the storm. There's a lot of things that happens on the other side of the storm. Aren't you glad that storms don't last forever? Tell you what, there's a lot of storms around us that build, and it's always good to see the sun come out and see the storm pass by and begin, maybe even see the rainbow hit the sky. It's good when the storm passes over. I want us to think this morning about on the other side. We can talk about the storms. We can wonder about the storms in our lives. And every person in this room, there's been storms in your life, or you may even be in a storm right now. And sometimes it's not whether you're in a storm, but it may be that you're getting ready to go in a storm, or maybe you've just come out of a storm in your life. Because life is that way. Life is full of difficulties, and life is full of struggles, and life is full of pain, and life is full of things. And so you say, well, preacher, give us some answers about the storms. I'll tell you something. A lot of people can come up with answers about the storms in people's lives. I'm not that smart. I realize that sometimes we put our own selves in storms. Self-inflicted storms. But there's some storms in life that we don't have any answers to other than say it's life. You know, why does an infant die? Why do you lose a loved one in a car crash at an early age? We don't have the answers. And I've walked by beside caskets this big, as well as the full size. And to be honest with you, no answer. And people would say, why? Why would it happen? And the best you can do is say, I don't know. But God always does what's right. And it's hard. And those storms in our lives and the difficulties and the struggles that we go through, and we don't have the answers to all the storms. And I've had people say, when I get to heaven, I'm going to ask why. And I really don't think that we will. I think when you get to heaven, if you're saved, you know Jesus Christ, you're saved, you get to heaven, you're going to automatically know, and you're going to automatically understand why. You won't have to ask why. But until then, yes, there's a question. But I want to look at something else this morning. I want to look at the other side of the storm. Because everybody's going to go through the storm. But I want you to focus on the other side of that storm. Some were prepared for the storm and some were not. In Genesis chapter 7, in verse 1, it says, And the Lord said unto Noah, Come thou and all thy house into the ark, for thee have I seen righteousness before me in this generation. Noah and his family had the warning of God come to them about the coming storm. They already knew the storm was coming. They had been preparing for the storm for a long time. They had been building the ark for a long time, so they were preparing. They knew God had already revealed to them that the storm was coming and that they needed to be ready for it. And then when the Lord was ready for the storm to come, and the ark was done, the Lord said, come thou and thy family into the ark. I want you to notice something there. If I had, Justin, come here, if Justin and I was going to my house, and we got to my house, and we would get to my house, I'd say, go on into the house. I said, go into the house, okay? But if I'm already at the house, in the house, and Justin is supposed to come to the house, when he gets there, I'm going to say, come on into the house. You say, well, preacher, we understand that. Look at the scripture there. Thank you. Let me see. The Lord said, come in to the ark. See, what are you saying? I'm saying the Lord was in the ark. Amen. Why? The Lord was in the ark. He said, come in. He didn't say, go in. He said, come in. And there's a reason for that. And I want you to get this, and don't ever forget it in your life. If you know Jesus Christ, your Savior, He's always going to say, come in. Because He's willing to go with you through the storm. Amen. You look at the disciples. They had forgot something that was very important. They had forgotten that God was in the ship. They had forgotten who He was. They had forgotten that He was already in the ship with them. And hey, listen, he was the one that could solve the problem. He's the one that could take care of that. And there was the fear of the hearts of the disciples. The storm came up upon them without any type of warning. And here they are, we find in Mark chapter 4 and verse 37 says, and there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship asleep on the pillow. And they awake him and say unto him, Master, carest not that thou we perish? He was already in the ship. They failed to understand who He was and in that ship and that He was there and that He would bring them through the storm to the other side of it. As we look at the storm that we're in and the destruction that's really building around us, if you begin to look, if you just turn the news on, if you just look at things, there's a storm brewing, a big storm. I'm just talking about life. And so, has it just started during this election cycle? No, it's been going on for a long time and just kept building every year. And the reason for that is that the Lord Jesus Christ is getting ready to come back. And when we find the scripture there, it says, this also know that in the last day, perilous times shall come. The last days, we've been living in the last days for quite a while. The thing of it is, the storm is just building and getting bigger and bigger, and we're preparing for the big storm. We're preparing for the day that the Lord will catch the church out, called the rapture of the church. We're preparing for the day when the church will be raptured out and the world will enter into what is known as a 7 years of tribulation, where God pours out the wrath of God upon those who are the unbelieving and those who have rejected the Lord Jesus Christ. And so that storm is building. Just like you'd go out and you begin to see those thunderheads roll up a little higher and a little higher all the time. The clouds begin to get darker and get a little darker, and the wind begins to blow a little bit and it gets a little bit stronger. If you was to go down over on the coast and ahead of the storms, I've watched some videos of it before, and even at different times when the hurricanes, people will go down and to the beaches, and the hurricane's coming in, and you can see the water begins to white cap, and the waves begin to roll in, and it begins to get stronger, and the wind begins to get stronger, and people will be down there along the beaches watching this thing roll in. It just begins to build and build and build. All around us, there's a storm building. Hey, listen, if you're saved, you need to realize who's in the ship with you and that He's able to carry you to the other side of the storm this morning. You say, preacher, are you worried about the days ahead? No, I'm really not worried about it. I'm just kind of a little bit excited about it. You say, why are you excited about a storm? Hey, listen, I used to work on electronics. Used to do electronics repair. And did a lot of TV repair and stuff. And I'm from down in southeast Missouri. And we would have a lot of lightning down there in rural Missouri. And you would have a lot of lightning damage to electronics and things. It would hit power lines. And boy, it just knocked out all kinds of stuff. And I did a lot of electronics repair. And so there was a man that I went to school with. His name's Jeff Parker. We was in the same church. He was the Farm Bureau agent. Saturday night would come a storm of lightning and crashing and banging and booming and everything. Sunday morning, I'd see Jeff and I'd say, I'm going to get in your pocketbook this week. Because I knew what the storm didn't bother me. Most men in this room, you know what most men do if they're talking about a tornado? They don't go to the basement. Where they go? They go outside. Why? They want to see this thing come. I mean, they want to see the storm coming. And they get excited about, hey man, I might get to see a tornado. I might, you know, I can see it. And they say, what are you going to do if it's coming at you? I'm going to run and jump in the basement, but I want to see this thing. Time and time again, I've stood at when Janine, and she would take the kids and she'd go to the basement and said, you better get down here. I said, I will. I'll get down there. I wanted to see this thing if it was coming. In the storm that we're in now, the return of the Lord Jesus Christ and the perilous times, yes, I don't like it. It causes destruction. But my friend, I'm not afraid of it. Because I'm anchored in somebody that will not allow me to be blown away by it. That's Jesus Christ. Well, I'll tell you what, it's good to be anchored. It's good to know that you're secure. It's good to know that if you was to die today, that you'd go to heaven. And that's why I'm not worried about it. And so we see this storm that's coming in our lives, and we need to realize, hey, listen, if you're saved, who's in the ship with you? And if you're not saved this morning, hey, listen, not prepared for the storm, the last days, the perilous times that the Bible's talking about. Hey, listen, you can listen to the voice of the one named Jesus who's calling unto you, and He's calling you to come in and be saved. He wants to come into your heart and life and save you today. Because He doesn't want you to go through the storm without Him. It's a sad day when people go through a storm and they're devastated. I remember, most of us remember down in few years ago now, when the hurricane came into New Orleans there, and they had all that devastation down there, and some people, they stayed in their homes, and they stayed there, and I remember watching them rescuing people off of tops of houses and out of trees and all that sort of stuff because they wouldn't get out of the way of the storm. They weren't secure. And I think about people who don't know Jesus Christ, your Savior, and Jesus Christ is trying to pluck you out of that storm before you die and go to a devil's hell. And you're saying, no, I'll stay right where I'm at. And my friend, I want you to understand something. That storm will take you over and destroy you in a lake of fire for eternity. Too many times we fail to see the need of receiving Christ our Savior until it's too late. So what was on the other side of the storm? In Genesis chapter 8 and verse 10 says, and he stayed yet another 7 days. He's in the ark here. And says he stayed yet other 7 days. And again, he sent forth the dove out of the ark. And the dove came in to him in the evening, and lo, in her mouth was an olive leaf plucked off. So no one knew that the waters were abated from off the earth. We see two things here. One thing that we see the dove, which is a sign of peace. The dove would say, hey, listen, everything's peaceful out there. Everything's fine and everything's good. And then we see that the dove brings in a leaf off of an olive tree. A picture of new life after the flood. New beginnings. Second, we see that olive leaf. For the disciples in the ship with Jesus, there was a peace on the other side of the storm. There was a salvation for the Gadarean demonic and a new beginning on the other side of the storm. The storms are not a bad thing, because once you get through the storm, there's some great things. Hey, listen, we see the peace that can be given only by Jesus Christ in a person's life. I remember before I got saved, I don't know if you do, but I stop and think about the time that I was lost and on my way to a devil's hell. And I remember laying awake at night. We lived in a mobile home, and I remember there's some big maple trees at the end of that mobile home, and I remember in a storm that those limbs would kind of slap the side of that mobile home, the roof of it and everything. And I remember laying there awake at night thinking, if that tree comes crashing down on top of this mobile home where I'm sleeping, it's going to send me out into eternity. I'm going to die and go to a devil's hell. And there was an upset in my life, and I couldn't sleep, and there was always a worry and always a problem with dying and going to a devil's hell. I remember going to public school, and And the principal there, I was going to church, but there was the principal, high school principal that we had, his name was Mr. Thompson. And then I had an algebra teacher, his name was Mr. Bridges. And both of them went to the church that I was going to. And I still remember walking into Mr. Bridges' walking into the algebra class before school had started, and Mr. Bridges was writing on the board, and I walked in, and I walked to the back where my seat was and put my books down. I was going to talk to Mr. Bridges about getting saved. I was tore up. He turned around at me and looked at me. He said, Rodney, he says, can I help you with something? I said, No. Everything's fine. I turned around and walked out the door. I remember being such turmoil in my life, thinking I would like for some reason to get called to the principal's office so I could ask Mr. Thompson how to get saved. That's wanting it pretty bad, to have to go to the principal's office. And there was that turmoil in my life, and that struggle, there was no peace. But I remember in the middle of May on a Wednesday night in 1975, getting up out of that seat back there. I was sitting with a girlfriend, my teenage friends there, getting up and leaving there and coming down to that altar and receiving Christ as my Savior. In fact, I got saved before I ever got to that altar. Hey, listen, I had already surrendered before I ever reached that altar. And man, there was a peace that came to my life. It was just like a load lifted off of me. A peace. Boy, on the other side of the storm, there's a peace. You say, preacher, can you really explain it? There's no way of explaining that type of peace. They say, and I don't want to experience, don't want to know it. They say when a hurricane comes across, that you'll have all that devastation from that wind and everything as it cuts across. And then when you reach the middle of that hurricane, it said it's dead still. It's quiet. They said it's almost eerie. But it's quiet. And I've heard them say that it's actually almost peaceful. Of course, then the rest of it comes through and gets you again. The fact is, hey, listen, when the storm is gone in your life by receiving Jesus Christ as your Savior, then you've got a new beginning. Just like that dove brought in that green leaf and showing that there was new life had started. Everything had been destroyed. And now here's this dove that says, hey, listen, there's peace out there. And bringing in that leaf and saying, hey, listen, there's a new beginning. There's new life. I want you to know something. When I got saved, it didn't make me perfect. But boy, it sure did change my life. There was new beginnings. There was a new desire to live for the Lord in a greater way than I ever had before. And realize that, hey, listen, now I know that I'm going to heaven. There was a new beginning and a new stirring in my heart and life. If you're saved, you know what I'm talking about. And probably if you don't know what I'm talking about, you're probably not saved. Amen. The thing of it is, hey, listen, on the other side of the storm, there's peace. And I look at this world today and there's so much turmoil and so much anxiety going on, and there's no peace in people's lives. I look at people's lives, and there's no peace. I mean, they're in turmoil all the time. I was at Walmart last night, and I was standing over here, and there was some people over here. And I mean, well, I'll just call it. And here comes a manager down. I'm going to say, it's just macaroni salad. Who cares? It'll probably upset your stomach anyway. You think I'm exaggerating? No. Over what? Macaroni salad. And there's no peace. We see it. We're seeing all kinds of protest and all kinds of this and all kinds of that. And they're marching against the police officers and they're marching against this and they're marching. There's no peace. No peace. But I'm going to tell you something. When you get on the other side of the storm with Jesus Christ, there's peace. I remember going home after I got saved, and I'd go to bed, and I remember the storms coming then and hitting those trees and everything, and I just slept right through it. There's a lot of times my wife the next day, she said, did you hear that storm last night? I said, nope. She said, how can you sleep through that? I said, peace with God. What's your problem? That doesn't go very well. And there's that new beginning, there's that new life that comes, and it's an exciting life that the Lord has for you. Disciples, when they come across the other side there, on the other side of the storm, there was an altar also and an awe. We find the disciples were in awe on the other side of the storm. In verse 41 of Mark chapter 4, it says, "And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, what manner of man is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" On the other side of the storm here, on the other side of the storm, the storm's done went by. Now they're on the other side. They've seen the peace come in. They've seen the Lord Jesus Christ get up and speak peace unto it and cause the seas to calm down, stop the winds and cause the clouds to move out and the stars to come out and just a clear night. And they begin to see that there was a peace there. And they said, what kind of man is this? Wow. We've never seen anything like this. And there was an awe. When you see the storms of life calmed by the mighty hand of God, you can't help but stand in awe of a mighty God. Amen. Our problem today is in Christians' lives, we don't realize who our Savior is well enough. We don't understand the mighty hand of God like we ought to. And we're always running to a credit card. We're always running to a therapist. We're always running to this. We're always running to that. Instead of running to the Lord Himself, who is the Almighty God, can handle all things. Amen. You find in Luke chapter 1, verse 30, says that for with God nothing shall be impossible. Boy, I like that. But Sam, I like that, man. Nothing. There's absolutely nothing my God can't do except fail me. He can't do that. With God, nothing's impossible. He's a mighty God. We find over in Jeremiah 32 and verse 17, it says, "Ah, Lord God, behold, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power and stretched out arm, and there is nothing too hard for thee." And many times what we do, we begin to look around and say, man, I don't know what we're going to do. I don't know what we're going to do. How are we going to handle it? How's this going to take? Did you think about talking to the one that's in the ship? I can imagine. Here you got the disciples in that ship. We're about to sing. What are we going to do? He's over asleep. What are we going to do? I mean, it's filling up with water. There's Peter over. I don't know. I don't care. And the whole time the answer was in the ship. And many times in our storms, we're wringing our hands and we're wondering what we're going to do. And the answer's in the ship. The answer's right there. And there's nothing too hard for Him. And there's nothing impossible that He can't do. You say, well, preacher, what do? The same thing they did. Lord, here's my situation. Here's where we're at. The ship's sinking. And He can calm the seas. He can stop the winds. He can stop the rain. My friend, He can put you on dry ground. They were in awe. Do you remember the day that you got saved? It ought to stir your heart. I look around the room here, and I'm looking at some of you. I'm saying, do you remember the time you got saved? And some of you are like, mm-hmm. You realize what you got when you got saved? I mean, you got plucked out of the muck and the mire, out of that horrible pit, and you set on a solid rock, and the Lord established your going, and you, because of that, you have eternal life. Do you realize that when you got saved, that He snatched you from an eternal lake of fire, and now you have eternal life in heaven forever and ever and ever and ever? Amen. And we can say, oh, yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, y'all stand up and say, I don't know how God did it. But, oh, praise the Lord. I look around here and I look at some of you and I don't know how He saved some of you either. He said, is there anyone too hard for Him to save? No. Do you remember the answered prayers in your life and when God did different things? I remember, hey, listen, I could just stand here and just begin to go over prayer after prayer after prayer after prayer after prayer after prayer. I remember praying for the longest time, and our kids would pray for my uncle to get saved, and we'd pray for him. And to be honest with you, I had come to a place where I had almost given up. We'd pray for him for so long. I had witnessed to him. We had given him gospel tracts and talked to him. He was a good man, and once in a while he would go to church and everything, but he was a good man. His mother, my grandmother, was a godly lady and loved the Lord, was in church, and so was my grandpa. And my mom, before my mom died, she looked at me and she looked at my brother and she said, I want you to witness to your uncle. I want to see him get saved. And my mom passed away. She got to see him get saved. 89 years old. Walked in and talked to him and said, Uncle Lynn, he'd been having some heart problems. He'd been healthy all his life. I said, if you died today, do you know you go to heaven? He said, no. I said, would you like me to show you how you could know? He said, yes, I would. And as I answered a prayer, praying for years for him to get saved, baptized him when he was 91. Man, that may not bother you because it wasn't your uncle, but I'll tell you what, he gets next to me, I love it. And I begin to think about the answer to prayer in different situations in God through my life, how God's answered prayer and answered prayer. Oh, I'll tell you what, it's good to know a Lord and Savior that cares about your prayers. You remember the work that He's done in the lives of those around you. And I could stand here, and we don't have the time to go over and over and over different ones. I've watched Him change their lives, and I stand in awe. I think of some people over the years that I thought, man, it almost looks like it's impossible for them to get saved, and watch God change them and save their soul and change their lives, and you're like, wow. Wow. Only God can do that. On the other side of the storm, there's an awe when you see what God can do. On the other side of the storm, there was an altar. An altar is where sacrifices are made and where you worship the Lord God of heaven. And in Genesis chapter 8 and verse 20 says, and Noah built an altar unto the Lord and took of every clean beast and of every clean fowl and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And here's Noah. He's finally, the door has been opened on the ark, and he comes out of the ark, and then one of the first things that Noah does is build an altar unto God. Why? To thank Him, to worship Him, to exalt Him. Boy, I'll tell you what's needed today in Christians' lives is, hey, listen, we need to get on the other side of that storm and begin to thank Him and begin to worship Him, begin to thank Him for what He's done in our hearts and life. But even before we get on the other side, there ought to be a worship of Him. And hey, listen, even during the storm, we ought to be thanking Him and praising His name and worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ so that this whole world can see Him high and lifted up. Jesus Christ said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. And I realize He's talking about the cross, but I believe that He's also talking about you and I lifting Him up before others that they might see Him, that He might be magnified in their eyes so that they could see the saving power of Jesus Christ. Oh, how we need to worship Him. That altar is a place where you die out to self, a place where you worship the Lord, a place where you magnify Him in your life and let others see Jesus Christ living within you. On the other side of that storm, Noah didn't care what everybody would have thought. Of course, there wasn't anybody around except for family. He built an altar. And he worshiped the Lord. I'm going to tell you something. Even during the storm, though, we ought to be worshiping the Lord. Before the Gadarene demonic, you go back and look at it, before the Gadarene demonic ever got saved, the Bible says he came running and he fell down and worshiped the Lord. Before the demons were even cast out, those demons knew who Jesus Christ was and they fell on their face before Him. Hey, you and I know who Jesus Christ is. Oh, how we ought to fall on our face before Him and worship Him. If the devil and his angels can recognize who Jesus Christ is, and worship Him. Why can't you and I do the same? I'll tell you what, there should not be a person in this room, if you know Jesus Christ, that should ever be ashamed to mention the name of Jesus. Never be ashamed to lift Him up. Never be ashamed to give Him praise. Never be ashamed to give Him honor and glory. Never be ashamed to tell others about Jesus Christ. Never be ashamed to say, He's my Savior and I know that He's redeemed my soul and I'm on my way to heaven. Amen. Say, preacher, you sound like you're convinced. Oh, I'm more than convinced. He's a mighty God. And oh, how there ought to be an awe in our lives and how we ought to worship Him and how we ought to lift Him up. And lastly, the blessing came on the other side of the storm. Verse 1 of chapter 9 of Genesis says, And God blessed Noah. God blessed him. Why? Because Noah was faithful. He served the Lord. He obeyed the Lord. And so God brought him through the storm. And after the storm, on the other side of the storm, there was a blessing waiting for Noah. Can I tell you something? After you get saved, there's a blessing that you can't count. The blessings begin to come and the blessings are beyond our imagination. When we remain faithful during this storm, the Lord will abundantly bless our lives. You say, preacher, what's that? Hey, going to heaven, isn't that blessing enough? Seeing the hand of God moving your life, isn't that blessing enough? But I can count the blessings and begin to name them one by one. And like the kids sing this, it says, name them one by one, name them ton by ton. The blessings of God. After I got saved, come out of that storm, man, I've seen God bless and God bless and God bless and God bless. In so many ways, that it's hard to even relate to why God would do it. The Gadarene demonic's life was changed. He had a second chance. And he was able to go back to his family and friends and tell them what Jesus had done. Here's a man who lived in the tombs, pulling clothes off. They had put clothes on him and he would rip them off. And they had bound him with chains and fetters. And he would break them because of the demons in him. There was so many in him, that unreal strength that was in him. He would break them and he would holler and scream and run through the tombs cutting himself. And now they come and they see him. He's sitting clothed and in his right mind at the feet of Jesus. And he asked the Lord, he said, let me go with you. And Jesus said, no, you go back to your family and to your friends and you tell them what the Lord's done in your life. You tell them what's happened. Can you imagine when he walks in, maybe to his home that he'd been away from for so long, and he steps in and his wife looks at him and she don't even recognize him. He's a different man. He said, I got a new lease on life. I got my family back. I got my mind back. I'm going to live for Jesus Christ. Goes to his next door neighbors, begin to tell him what Jesus Christ, what a blessing. The blessing on the other side of the storm. Now, real quickly, let me take you back. 2 Timothy chapter 3, this also know, that in the last days perilous times shall come, and it begins to list all things. And by the way, if you read that and you look at it, it looks like our newspaper of today. There's a word in there that a lot of people get hung up on. They don't know what it means. Incontinent means without self-control. It's a medical term. And we are living in a day when there is no self-control. And it is a picture of America in this world. Right now. Last days. Last days. The storm's building. Say, preacher, what about the other side of the storm? On the other side of the storm, I have a question for you. Where will you be? If you know Jesus Christ, your Savior, you'll be in heaven. If you don't, you'll be in a lake of fire on the other side of the storm. But right now, the storm's building, and you have an opportunity. As the Lord said to Noah, come in to the ark. Jesus said, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. If any man will open and let me in, I will come in and sup with him and he with me. This morning, if you're not saved, he stands and he knocks at your heart's door, wanting entrance into your life, that you might have eternal life, that he can take you through the storm, that he can bless your life, that you can see the mighty hand of God, and you'll stand in awe of what he'll do in your life. A new beginning and a peace in your heart that you've never experienced before. And Christian, this morning, the storm's coming. Don't be afraid of the storm. Stand in awe of the Lord. Magnify him. Lift him up. That the world might seem that they might know Jesus Christ. But it's going to take Christians who have decided in their hearts and lives that they're going to live for him. Not play games. We got too much of this Christianity that's playing games. I'm not talking about all this churchy stuff. I'm talking about living for Jesus Christ. I'm not talking about just being a member of a church. I'm talking about living for Jesus Christ, that others might see him in you. Every head bowed, every eye closed, no one looking around. Oh, this morning, the storm's building, and it's coming. Where will you be on the other side? With every head bowed, every eye closed, no one looking around, could I ask you a question? I'll not embarrass you. I'll not come to you. I want to be able to pray for you. I'll not call you by name or anything. With nobody looking around, can I ask you this question? If you was to die today, do you know that you go to heaven? How many would say, preacher, if I died today, I know that I'd go to heaven. Would you slip up your hand? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You can put them down. Not every hand could be raised. Can I tell you that the Lord doesn't want you to guess about it? In 1 John chapter 5, verse 13, he said, these things have I written on you that you might know that you have eternal life. You can know. Come during the invitation. Let us take a Bible and show you how to receive Jesus Christ before it's too late. The storm's building. It's building. We just don't know when it's going to hit. Father, thank you for loving us. Thank you for the mercies of God. Not every hand was raised. You know the hearts. You know each person. And Lord, so I pray that you'd draw, that you'd work. But I pray as Christians here, Lord, some are going through some storms in their lives right now. Help them to realize, Lord, that they can, that there's peace on the other side of the storm because you're in the ship with them. Help them to lean upon you. May they just need to find a place, Lord, and draw close to you this morning. Lord, you said if we draw nigh to you, you draw nigh to us. May we do that as Christians today. May we stand in awe. May we worship you. May we lift you up. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand.